Oh, yes.
Right. So, very warm welcome to all the esteemed faculty and dignitaries for this program of Mission Kovind Uday, which is being hosted jointly by Indian Academy of Pediatrics Pune branch, Nagpur branch, and Raigad branch. Today, we have an excellent team to take us through the important points of this COVID, especially in adults as well as pediatrics. I welcome Honorary Secretary General Basavaraj sir. Joined the West Zone Vice President Upadhyay sir, National Coordinator for this module Ajay Kumar Gupta sir, EB members from the West from Maharashtra Anil Raut sir and Anand Deshpande sir, as well as the Presidents of Nagpur and Raigad Vijay Dhote and Smita Ingre ma'am, and Secretaries from Raigad Nilima ma'am and Pramod Kulkarni sir, Secretary from Pune, and I am Dr. Sanjay Nathu, President of IIP Pune branch. So I think we are at a stage now in Maharashtra where the cases are now starting to decline, but we all know that the MISC cases are starting to increase, and it's very likely that we may get further surges, and we don't know as of now whether pediatric cases are going to be high in that, as has been discussed repeatedly at various places. Anyway, so this is a very important module, and this topic will remain important for the next foreseeable future, maybe 6 months to 1 year. So to begin this module, since Basavaraj sir is busy, I request Dr. Jayant Upadhyay sir to please say a few words. He is the Vice President of the West Zone. Sir, unmute yourself, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sanjay Nathu, respected yes, our National President, Professor Piyush Gupta ji, and our immediate past president, Dr. Bukul Jayant Parikh sir, and president-elect Dr. Ramesh Kumar, and our West Zone Vice President, Dr. Jayant Upadhyay. Let me congratulate our IIP Maharashtra branch led by Dr. Jayant Pandrikar and Sadachar, along with IIP Pune, Dr. Sanjay Nathu, and Professor Pramod Kulkarni sir, and our IIP Nagpur branch, Dr. Vijay P. Dhote sir, and Dr. Pankaj Agarwal, our Raigad branch, Dr. Sunita Madam and Nilima Madam, along with our executive board member, Dr. Anil Rawat, Anand Deshpande, Dr. Parmanand Anandkar, Dr. Prashant Jadhav. Really, they have done a tremendous Narendra Nanevadekar, they have done a tremendous job organizing the COVID module across Maharashtra. All the credit should go to all the team members. And coming to this module is well conceptualized by none other than our Golden Jubilee President, Dr. C.P. Bansal sir, along with Dhiren Guptaji, Dr. Tanu Singhal madam, Dr. Samir Dalwai, and Swati Ghate, and Vipin Vasishta. So this job was given to execute it to our Dr. Ajay Guptaji, our national coordinator, and our joint national coordinator, Dr. Anand Deshpande. So they have done a tremendous job for last 2 months. Almost they conducted today is then a 58th program, 58. So that's something amazing in a matter of just in 1 month. So not only they have conducted it, and every time there's a new literature is coming, they are changing the things. That's a great thing about today's faculty. Dr. Anand Deshpande is talking about adult, and Dr. Upendra ji is already spoken. Vaccine is so crisp, clear. And love to hear to Dr. Upendra ji. Welcome, Dr. Upendra ji. So with these few words, now I request all the faculties and delegate to wish you all the best. Thank you. Wish you happy learning. Over to Dr. Sanjay.
Thank you, sir. And we appreciate how enthusiastic you are in all those modules, sir. Thank you. And as you rightly said, we tried to get this module 15 days back, but they told us all the slots are full. So sorry, you have to wait. So we had to take in the last week of May now. I request Dr. Jayant Upadhyay sir, Vice President West Zone, to speak a few words.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Dr. Sanjay. Dr. Piyush Gupta, our President, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, President-elect, Dr. Basavaraj, Dr. Bakul sir, all three in their absentia, Dr. Basavaraj, who is present on the panel, our HSG, Dr. Anil Raut, National Executive Board Member, and Dr. Anand Deshpande, also National Executive Board Member and Joint National Coordinator, Dr. Ajay Gupta, who is National Coordinator of this module, Dr. Sanjay Nathu and Dr. Pramod Kulkarni, respected President and Secretary of Pune, Dr. Vijay Dhote and Pankaj Agrawal, President and Secretary of Nagpur branch, and Dr. Sunita Ingle and Dr. Nilima Bhandarkar, respected President and Secretary.
Bodhankar sir, can Alit.
Bodhankar sir, our
Uday Bodhankar sir is there. Welcome to Uday Bodhankar sir. Please allow sir as a panelist, DAP person.
Dr. sir, Dr. Bodhankar sir is there?
Yes. Sir, I agree.
Respected Dr. Yes, Bodhankar sir, patron of Nagpur IIP, past national president and our guide and our margadarshan. All the attendees yes. who are attending.
Correction, yeah. patron of not only Nagpur IIP, patron of Indian Academy of Pediatrics also, sir.
Yeah, I agree with you. He is a towering personality.
Welcome, sir.
Don't embarrass me. I am a simple IIP warrior.
You are a towering person who always stand behind me and all the IIPs.
Thank you very much for that, sir.
Welcome, yeah. sir. This is a comprehensive module prepared by IIP under leadership of Dr. Piyush Gupta, as already been told by Dr. Basavaraj, our HST. Many aspects of the COVID disease, prevention, diagnosis, management, and other psychosocial aspect, impact of COVID, everything has been discussed in a compact module, which will be useful not only in the management of pediatric COVID, but adult COVID as such, and gives a perfect overview of the disease as such. So it is going to be very useful for the pediatricians of India. And if we try to percolate this module to general practitioners and other doctors, that will be useful to them also. I don't want to stand in between you and the faculty. So I wish you all the panelists, all the best, and all the attendees, happy learning and happy sharing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I request Dr. Ajay Kumar Gupta, who is the national coordinator for the Mission COVID Uday module, to please say a few words. Dr. Gupta, sir.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Good afternoon. To our dignitaries on the dais, we'll have four modules. One is the COVID in adults. Second is the
your voice is breaking, Dr. Ajay.
Psychosocial issues. To manage not only the children, but also the adults, because we are getting many calls from the adult patients as well as our relatives. So wish you all a happy learning and all the best.
Thank you, sir. Now I think we can move towards the first session. The first session is on COVID in adults, and I invite
Sanjay,
the chat for, sir.
I'll request you to kindly give 1 minute to Dr. Bodhankar, sir.
Yes, of course, sir. Dr. Bodhankar, sir, if you can please express yourself.
I think no formality, Jayan. Thank you very much, Dr. Basarath, Dr. Jayan Upadhyay, Dr. Upendra, and all the EBM of IIP and all the speaker. I will not take my time. Thank you very much for giving honor. Koveen, I was attending the that debate on Sunday with the Honorable CM. There were too many questions. They were there, and there were so many misinformation which was not said by our IIP people like Yevle, Dr. Prabhu, Dr. Anandar. So I think we should clear it, because there was so many things that there was a misinformation that flu, if you give flu vaccine, then you can prevent COVID in the children. So, but it was never said by, I was there from 12 to 2:30. So Basara sir, we need to clarify from IIP background.
Today I'll be having NDTV interview is there at 6:30.
Yeah, please. I'll clear this one. Apart from that, we should have something from IIP. We should go to all the media and all the TV.
Sure, sir.
Bakul Parekh, Ramesh Kumar, and you and all vice versa, so that there is miss. They are taking into account that IIP said like that. I said I was there. IIP never said like that. I was continuously from 12. This is only what I would like to share with all people who are there. Thank you very much. Go ahead with academic fees. I will not come in between, but this is I wanted to share, but there were many queries, Upendra. So we must clear this in the minds of all pediatricians, also in the public. thank you, Basarat.
Thank you so much, Uday Bodhankar, sir. Definitely we'll take it up, your advice.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. I invite the chairpersons for the first session now. Dr. Anil Rao, who is the executive board member for the Central IIP from Maharashtra. Dr. Sadachar, I think, is unable to join right now. And Dr. Vijay Dhote, sir, who is the president of the Indian Academy of Pediatrics Nagpur branch. I request them to take over and introduce the speaker and the experts. Dhote, sir, you are muted, sir.
Dhote, sir, you please start.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everybody. Central CIIP President Dr. Piyush Gupta, sir, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, Dr. Bakul, sir, Honorary Secretary Dr. G.V. Basavaraj, sir, National Vice President, Mesh Zone Dr. Jayant Upadhyay, all the respected conveners and coordinators, Dr. Anil Raut, and all the respected CIIP EB members, Dr. Jayant Pandrikar, who is President of MahaIIP, I think he has not joined yet, Dr. Sadachar Udayamankar, who is Secretary of MahaIIP, President Dr. Sanjay Nathu from Pune branch, Secretary Dr. Pramod Kulkarni from the Pune branch, Dr. Sunita Ingle, President IIP Raigad branch, Dr. Nilima Bandarkar, Secretary IIP Raigad branch, Dr. Pankaj Agrawal, Secretary AOP Secretary Nagpur branch, and all the respected dignitaries, participants of this module. As we know, COVID pandemic has affected life of millions of people, including children. The pandemic has made huge impact on physical, economical, emotional, social, and psychological well-being of all human beings. Providing basic knowledge through this module will be helpful for the clinicians in managing and guiding the people and children suffering from COVID-19 disease. We are having experts like Dr. Anand Deshpande, Dr. Anil Raut, Dr. Parmanand Andankar, and Dr. Upendra Kinjwadekar for guiding us in this module. I am thankful and I congratulate all the speakers, and I'm also thankful and congratulate all the attendees. Now, our first session is on adult COVID, and the speaker is Dr. Anand Deshpande, and expert is Dr. Jayant Upadhyay. In short, I shall be introducing both the Dr. Anand Deshpande as well as Dr. Jayant Upadhyay. Dr. Anand Deshpande is also EB member. He is an eminent pediatrician practicing at Pune. He is consultant at Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital, and to his credit, many achievements are there. Dr. Jayant Upadhyay, as he is from my branch, I know a lot of things about him. Most important introduction is my best friend. He runs his own hospital in Nagpur as well as his attached to Colors Hospital. He is also ex-EB member. At present, he is Vice President CIIP. And most important thing is that he was the organizing secretary for the most coveted and most acknowledged Pedicon 2018. Am I correct, Jayant? Pedicon 2018. Now I request Dr. Anand Deshpande to deliver his speech on adult COVID. Anand, please.
Am I audible?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Thank you for those kind words. And I think we would start with the first presentation. Let me share my screen. Able to see the screen?
Yeah. No, screen is, yes, now it is visible.
Dr. Deshpande, open PPT first. Huh?
I haven't opened it. It is there. I have to open it first.
Yeah, double click on the PPT part.
Is screen seen or not seen?
Okay, yes. Screen is. It's okay. Opening up.
Read only.
थोडे उघडायला वेळ लागणार वाटतं
असं दिसतंय. हा उघडले.
हा उघडलं. स्लाइड शो.
Yes, okay. It is visible now. Okay.
So, this module, as everybody knows, has been designed around January, and we first TOT occurred in the February, physically in Mumbai. Thereafter, it has been modified time and again, as per the change in the disease presentation. Now, first of all, our question would come to our mind, why learn the adult COVID? Now, there are multiple reasons for that. Number one is there is no any separate research in the pediatric population as disease is less common as compared to adult. So whatever is research is done in pathophysiology as well as in the therapeutics investigation, that is extrapolated to the pediatric population. Number two is there are several cases of when there is will be pandemic, and there will be number of cases will be more as it occurred in last month. We are supposed to help our adult colleagues and control the situation because we are basically MBBS doctors. Sometime or other in this pandemic, we are likely to suffer ourselves. Somebody close near dear to our is likely to suffer. These are the multiple reasons why we should know the adult COVID very well. And once you know adult COVID very well, it becomes very easy to assimilate and understand the pediatric COVID disease. So let us begin now. So this module is basically prepared for the practicing pediatrician and is not giving more focus on how to ventilate COVID patient and how to manage the hospital based or hospital admitted COVID patient. So this purpose of this module is basically a stratification of the patients and classify patient high versus risk, low risk is the basic purpose. Target of catching patients before 94% saturation they reach, essential of home and ward care, and use so we are a clinician and we are always doing stratification. Whenever patient comes to our OPD, we always stratify the risk and decide whether I can manage this patient in the OPD basis or whether I require this patient to be admitted in a local hospital or whether this patient is going to complicate and will require some hospital with an ICU backup or a specialized backup or subspecialties setup. These things are we are doing for years together. The same thing we have to do in COVID. A classic example is of dengue. The 60 to 70% dengue patients can be managed on the OPD basis. About 10 to 15% will require hospital admission. About 5% would require ICU management. Same thing applies to the COVID. This module is prepared by Dr. Dhiren Gupta, and he has worked in adult COVID. As soon as the lockdown started, he had no pediatric ward, and adult COVID work started increasing. Out of interest, and he went into adult COVID, and he has treated ample number, thousands of COVID patients. And out of this, that experience, the birth of this module has come. So disclaimer is that all the cases mentioned in this module are real. So these are the different types of presentation of COVID. Most common is acute COVID asymptomatic. Second most common is a acute COVID URTI low risk patient. And third common is high risk without hypoxemia. And fourth common or less common is acute COVID pneumonia. So basically we are going to learn how to stratify on this. For this learning, this family of six, family of ASHI, they are all OBs, is going to help us to understand how to stratify. There is a 77-year male, diabetes mellitus, day 6, has a body ache, weakness, HbA1c 6. Another 57-year female, diabetes mellitus, day 9, fever, and HbA1c 8.4, uncontrolled diabetes. 72-year female, diabetes mellitus, 5th day, body ache, fever, HbA1c not available. 50-year female, 8th day, asymptomatic. 46-year female, 7th day, pain in the throat. 55-year female, 9th day, no symptoms. So these are six patients, and amongst them, we are going to stratify and see the, in a way, all are, of them are high risk from the one point of view that all are obese. Obesity is supposed to be high risk situation for COVID. This stratification, whom to treat, where to treat, how to select high risk patients. So where to treat? Low risk patients you treat in the home monitoring. High risk patient asymptomatic in the home or in the COVID care center depending on the availability. At the peak of epidemic, you will not find place for high risk asymptomatic in the COVID care center. High risk symptomatic necessarily requires hospital treatment. High risk symptomatic with saturation less than 95%, it has to be managed in hospital with ICU backup. What are the high risk situation? These are changing a little bit, but this criteria very, very well fit to the first wave. High risk age more than 50, comorbidity, obesity and diabetes, family history of death due to acute COVID. It is well known that there are brothers in the family dying within a period of week, or so there is some unknown genetic factors which will come, we don't know right now, that poses the person for extra susceptibility to the severe COVID. Male sex is also more prone for the complicated disease. AB blood group is more prone for the complicated disease. There are some 10 to 20% patients which will not have the high risk situation, but in spite of not being in high risk situation, they will behave high risk and they will progress rapidly. But this rule generally will apply to majority of the patient. What are high risk symptoms? Persistent fever more than 5 days. High grade fever more than 102 Fahrenheit beyond 2 days. Generally in COVID, beyond 2 days, there is no high grade fever. Chills and rigors, breathlessness, biphasic fever. Fever was there up to 4 or 5 days. The fever disappeared, again reappeared on the 7th day. Or fever was there up to 6 day, disappeared, again appeared on 8th and 9th day. This is an ominous sign. Investigation, rising inflammatory markers, significant chest infiltrates in radiology, hypoxemia, drop from the baseline. These are the high-risk situation. Now, with this, once we know what are high-risk situations, the last three patients of ours are out of our stratification, that we know that they are low risk and they don't require any stratification or any extra effort on them because they are asymptomatic. One has pain in throat and like that. So we will concentrate on the upper three patients. So next step is to closely watch for oxygenation, inflammation, D-dimer, CRP, ferritin, CBC, KFT, and LFT. Home care. What are the prerequisites of home care? Home care should have a written management. It should have an emergency plan. If nothing goes according to the plan, some complication occurs, so where we are going to admit, what is the place, how we are going to manage, that should be thought earlier, not when it comes, the situation comes to that. Monitoring and follow-up should be there. It should be at some regular interval. Monitoring and follow-up should be at some regular interval. There should be pulse oximetry available. Caregiver availability should be there. Somebody should be there to give care. Nearby health facility should be there. Home collection of investigation should be there, which is possible mainly in the cities and up to taluka places. This is quite. Having uncontrolled anxiety, he cannot be managed at home because every now and then he will keep on calling. Oxygen cylinder, if asking for oxygen cylinder is too much, especially when there is a peak of the epidemic, but steroid dose definitely should be there. Avoid uncontrolled diabetic with obesity for home care. Home care should be avoided in diabetes with obesity. But when the pandemic becomes very severe, when the hospital beds are blocked, you will have to treat all sorts of patients at home also. This is a written protocol. This is a paper you should send by mail or something to the patient and ask them to keep the record. The charting should be there. The charting should be of the symptoms, of the SpO2, of the investigations. If some investigations are done, then the investigation should be charted. And whenever you are doing a call, you ask the patient to do a 6 minutes walk test before that. Thereafter, you do a video call. And after 6 minute walk test, look for the saturations. And you personally look for the saturation on the video call. Don't rely on the patient and he will say they are all right. You have to see personally whether the saturations are all right. And after putting the saturation meter, you should wait for 30 seconds, 1 minute, because it gives a variable results in initial phases and later on it stabilizes. So this family of ASHI will be continued after the basic understanding of the disease. So how do we have gathered the basic understanding of disease? Evidence, experience, and examples. And from that have come the recommendations. Then we'll look for the management. After understanding the pathogenesis, we'll come to know how the things are to be diagnosed and later on how to treat them. This chart and graph is very important for understanding the adult COVID or COVID in general. This is a day zero where the patient has acquired infection. The incubation period for this disease is between 5 to 7 days, approximately about 1 to 2 days before the symptoms, the patient becomes infective to the others. So he will be, he is then called as a contagion. Once he is infected to the others, he's contagion. So he'll become contagion after 3 to 4 days after he acquires infection, before he develops the disease. So he already spreads the disease to near and dear people if their masking and safe distancing is not maintained. He would spread the disease before he gets the disease. So this virus has a peculiarity that it blunts the, tomorrow in the vaccine lecture, we will see that this virus has a peculiarity. It has one non-structural protein in the is genetic code by which is able to delay the interferon response. Any virus, whenever it enters into the body, immediately gives interferon 1 and 3 response, and it is quite robust and there is hardly any delay. COVID, by some mechanism, avoids this immediate response, and whatever response comes is normally half the response in other viruses. So because of this mechanism, the viral replication in case of a COVID will continue for a longish period. So it will continue. You see the triangle of viral replication going on. And by end of 5th to 7th day from the symptom, the viral replication normally would stop, 5th to 6th day. And the patient will feel better. And this will happen in almost majority of the patients, and they will get relief. But in some patients, for whatever reasons, they will have dysregulated inflammation and inflammatory coagulopathy. Delayed innate immunity in the form of the interferon response is primarily responsible for the more viremia. If more viremia, there will be more viral debris. The viral debris itself can also stimulate for the dysregulated inflammation and what we in short call as a cytokine storm. Some patients will not get anything out of this. They will not respond after the viral replication and will directly land into the hyperinflammatory syndrome, especially in the 0 to 18 age group that we are just talking about, that it will come 3 to 4 weeks after the peak of the epidemic. And some unfortunate will go into the chronic lung disease and post-COVID state. What are the common symptoms of COVID-19? Headache, cough, sore throat, shortness of breath or difficulty in breathing, nausea or vomiting, diarrhea, congestion or runny nose, new loss of taste or smell. In first wave, this was taken as a sign of a milder disease. The person who lost taste or smell was unlikely to be supposed to be not going to the severe disease. But there are exceptions in the second wave. Persons with the loss of taste and smell also have landed up into complications. Fatigue, muscle or body ache, fever or chills. These are the common symptoms. Uncommonly, it can have pancreatitis, it can have urinary symptoms, then it can involve have myocarditis. All rare complications are possible. So in investigation, we'll investigate at three levels. At the virus, identifying the virus, identifying or establishing. COVID, it will be helpful in the management of the post-COVID hyperinflammatory disorder. Inflammation will be documented by blood counts, C-reactive protein, ferritin, D-dimer. Pneumonia will be documented by either radiology, X-ray chest, high-resolution CT scan chest. The role of blood tests in the management of COVID. So these are the three main tests, CRP, D-dimer, and ferritin. Thrombophilic stage will have a more D-dimer. Early pulmonary stage will have a CRP and ferritin both gone up. Late pulmonary emphysematopathic stage will have all the three which have gone up. And late pulmonary with macrophage activation syndrome will also have all CRP, D-dimer, and ferritin, especially ferritin, very strongly going up. Aim of this test is to predict and monitor the disease. C-reactive protein. When to be done? Day 5 onwards, if the symptom persists in high-risk individual. not indicated on a day one as a baseline after symptom onset. That gives a false assurance and will require further repetition. When CRP is significant, CRP more than 70 milligram per deciliter associated with low oxygen level is very significant. Patients with 40 milligram per liter will likely to have severe symptoms. Milder symptoms will have a CRP of 20 milligram per liter. Trend of CRP with persistence of symptom should be considered significant. As a pediatrician, we are accustomed to very high level of CRP of a bacterial infection. In a COVID disease proper, you will not have that high CRP levels. And if they are high, they are taken as an ominous sign. Hello?
Hello.
I am audible?
Yeah, you are audible, but the voice is being interrupted. Please go ahead.
Okay. So this is a case, this slide is depicted to show that many times you can have exception to the rule. This patient on the day 3 of admission on the Dexana 6 milligram BD, chest X-ray showing infiltrates and was hypoxic. It was required shifting to the ICU and HFNC. It had a CRP negative. All other parameters were high up. So you can have occasionally a CRP negative patient going bad. So alone alone CRP should not be relied upon. Coming to the D-dimer. The normal reference consideration of D-dimer is less than 400 nanogram per ml or 0.4 microgram per ml. D-dimer value on admission greater than 2000 nanogram, that is 2 microgram, could effectively predict in-hospital mortality of COVID-19 patients with a sensitivity of 92.3% and specificity of 83.3%. Helps in titrating anticoagulant therapy. D-dimer's level may be elevated in the setting of pregnancy, inflammation, malignancy, trauma, post-surgical treatment, liver disease, because in the liver disease, there is a decreased clearance of D-dimer, and in the heart disease. False positive, if you send it on, it should be preferably sent on the empty stomach. Lipemia, a high triglyceride level, an elevated bilirubin level, an elevated serum rheumatoid factor level, or a hemolysis can alter D-dimer. So this test has so many false positive reasons to be false positive. And that's why it should be interpreted with caution, looking at the clinical condition. The levels of D-dimer. In that case, you should isolate the plasma and it should be transported to the laboratory on dry ice. Otherwise, it will give a very fallacious result. Interleukin-6 does not always correspond to CRP. CRP is actually a surrogate marker of interleukin-6, which is produced by the hepatocytes in response to IL-6. IL-6 over 25 microgram per ml independent risk factor for the progression to the severe disease or in-hospital mortality. IL-6 more than 80 picogram per ml in combination with C-reactive protein more than 97 milligram is highly predictive of respiratory failure. This investigation also requires trends, and a single IL-6 level should not be given importance. Then there should be, if the sample is not sent on ice or not sent properly, there will be false positive in IL-6. But IL-6 is generally not done or should not be done in a home admitted patient and if it is done, the precaution of taking it to the lab properly and within required time should be followed. This is a at least 24 to 36 hours before it occurs. Here in this patient, on day 11, the CRP was 4.25. On day 14, it became 18.4. And day 15, it became 31.4. On day 14 also, there was a low-grade fever. So you can predict the likelihood of SpO2 fall by if you are tracking the CRP level serially. The trend of CRP, IL-6, predicted the severe disease before hypoxemia sets in. Remdesivir doesn't carry no pneumonia. This patient had received remdesivir, so everybody was a little less worried that patient has received remdesivir is unlikely to complicate, but that is not the rule. Ferritin. Ferritin is a marker of a macrophage activity. Increase in ferritin value as a marker of prognostication and predictor, especially thrombosis in the diabetics. Ferritin is the last marker which will return to the normal, will lag by 5 days after CRP. Trend rather than the threshold, 700 plus of the laboratory results provides most information. Rising ferritin with a deranged LFT and developing cytopenias will predict macrophage activation syndrome. LDH. LDH is another important marker related to the respiratory function. You know that PaO2 upon FiO2 is very important for us. Normal PaO2 upon FiO2 is around 400 to 500, up to 450 to 500. When there is lung injury, it will fall down to below 300. In ARDS, it will fall down below 200. And this can be predicted by the lactate. The LDH levels. There is strong inverse correlation between LDH and PaO2 and FiO2 values. LDH showed that a cutoff value of 415 unit per liter had a sensitivity of 75% and a specificity of 70% in recognizing moderate and severe ARDS. So chest imaging.
Hello, Anand.
Is least evaluated, probably for whatever reason. No, nobody knows. But maybe the person has to go quite close to the COVID patient, and chances of getting infected. That may be the reason. But somehow ultrasound has not been tried much. So indication of chest imaging. When you like to go for the chest imaging? A patient comes to your hospital, you clinically feel that the patient is having a COVID and the test comes negative. The RT-PCR comes negative, the antigen test comes negative, and you want to decide on which side of your hospital you want to take, the COVID side or non-COVID side. You are in baffle. So at that time, HRCT will be of your help to clear the diagnostic dilemma. Then in differential diagnosis and in complications, one of the complications of the COVID is a pulmonary embolism. That time also HRCT will come to your help. Confusion in decision making. Patient is having fever, now it is 7th day, 8th day, still the saturations are very well, 8th or 9th day. Whether I need to give steroid, whether I should wait, what to do. In clearing such confusion, HRCT will help you. Now, and try to apply what you have learned to them. CRP 8, now in case number 1, CRP 18, total count 9,800, lymphocyte 5, polymorphs 95, D-dimer 211, SpO2 95, 77-year male, diabetes mellitus, day 8, cough weakness persisted, HbA1c 6. Both are maintaining saturation. CRP 8, in other case, 12,300, lymphocyte, look at the lymphocyte, 34, D-dimer 982. In first case, the lymphocytes are less. This is without steroid. After steroid, there is you cannot look at the lymphocyte as a prognostic marker. Before steroid, they can be used as for the prognostication. So lymphocyte, there is a lymphopenia in the first case. The other case, the lymphocytes are reasonably well maintained. So 57-year female, diabetes mellitus, day 11 of the fever persisting, HbA1c 8.4. No bed is available. Next step, steroids, antiviral, anticoagulant, what to do? That's why we advise HRCT. So on HRCT, the first case has a score of 14 over 25. And the second case where we said that lymphocytes are in good number came the score of 7 over 25. So case number 1 had moderate disease and case 2 has a mild disease. This is how the HRCT will come to our help. How to approach? Role of imaging. Chest CT protocol. There was a lot of noise about the chest CT causing a lot of radiation, more than 200 to 300 X-rays, but modern machines don't give that much radiation. And the protocol used for the COVID gives hardly radiation of about 4 X-rays. Non-contrast high-resolution chest CT, unless CT pulmonary angiography you are doing, then you will have a radiation which is on the higher side. But if you are not doing CT pulmonary angiography, then the radiation of lower side. Low radiation as much as possible, CT images should be acquired during a single inspiratory breath hold. No need for the expiratory film. HRCT, what is expected? In asymptomatic patient, if you do HRCT in asymptomatic patient, which should not be done, 46% will be normal. In symptomatic patients, within the first 5 days, again should not be done. 13% normal if done in the first 5 days. Symptomatic patients after 5 days, you have more than 97-98% patients will having some abnormality or other in the HRCT. There will hardly 1%, less than 1% will be normal in the second week who are symptomatic. So what are the CT changes? This is a GGO, that is a ground glass opacities, haziness with a bronchovascular marking in the background. Then that will go to the crazy filming with the septal thickening and superimpose over the GGO. Later on, it will go to the consolidation if the disease progresses, which show haziness with a bronchovascular marking not seen in the background plus air bronchogram. This is how it progresses. This is first HRCT showing GGO, and this is ARDS in the second one. CT changes over the time. For 0 to 5 weeks, subpleural GGO, 5 to 8 days, extensive GGOs, 9 to 13 days, crazy paving, more than 14 days onwards, consolidation. And later on, there will be fibrosis and subpleural band, more than 14 days onwards. Scoring. So there are two types of scoring. One is for suspicion and other is for the severity. CORAD score, developed by the Dutch radiologist. This CORAD score has classification is standardized reporting system for the patient with a suspected COVID-19 infection developed for a moderate to high prevalence setting. And severity score is developed by Chinese radiologists and shows the percentage of lung involved and lobe involved out of 25. This is 4-ADS score. 4-ADS 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Level of suspicion goes from no to very high. And if 4-ADS 6 is radiological changes with a PCR positivity. What are the uncommon changes on the HRCT? Pleural effusion is in 5.2%, tree in bud sign is in 4.1%, lymphadenopathy 5.1%, pericardial effusion 2.7%, and cavitating lung lesions less than 0.7%. The percentage of the lung involved as per the lobe, 0 is normal, 1 point is less than 5% abnormality, 2 points is 5 to 25% abnormality, 3 as 25 to 50% abnormality, 4 as 50 to 75%, and 5 score is more than 75% of the lobe is involved. 5 lobes, total score 25. Select the lobe on coronal plane, give scoring per lobe, then calculate and complete the scoring. This is called as 3D volume rendering is done and it is calculated. Remember, 5 out of 25 doesn't mean 20% lung involvement. Can I predict the clinical course on the basis of imaging? Has it any relation with the clinical score? CT severity score classification. My disease less than 7, 8 to 17 is a moderate disease, severe disease more than 18. CT score versus clinical course prediction in absence of hypoxemia. Once hypoxemia sets in, our treatment is decided. So we want to detect the patient whether it is likely to go into hypoxemia before actually hypoxemia sets in. That's why the whole exercise is there. So what they have found in one study, no hypoxemia in 50% patients with score 8 to 17. And there are only 3.3% with a severe scan result that who didn't require oxygen. So in severe CT scoring means the oxygen dependency is going to be there. And in moderate, there 50% will require oxygen. So HRCT score more than 8 with no clinical features, hypoxemia fever markers, you have, if you are low risk, you can have an intensive follow-up on day-to-day basis. If there is a lung involvement more than 50%, consolidation is present and age more than 50 with comorbidities, you have to manage on case-to-case basis with steroid, anticoagulants and antivirals in absence of hypoxemia. Coming back to our case of Ashi, here CRP was 18, D-dimer was 11, lymphocytes were 5, CT score was 14, 77-year male, that is first case. And we started looking at the CT score, that was 50% CT score of 14 is a quite significant score. Looking at that, there is a high possibility that patient is likely to require oxygen in any time, and a high-risk patient will require some treatment, and that's why we started Medrol 12 mg OD, enoxaparin 40 mg OD, and close monitoring for high-risk features. In other case, where the CT scan report came as 7, we decided not to give any treatment because likelihood it fell into the mild COVID range, so no treatment, close monitoring for high-risk features. This is how CT will help you. Now coming to the clinical definition severity of Indian government and what is the fallacy. Our health ministry has divided COVID into three groups: mild, asymptomatic, fever and URTI. Moderate pneumonia with SpO2 94% to 90% and RR 15 to 30 per minute. Severe SpO2 less than 90% and RR more than 30 minutes. A subset of patients with radiologically moderate disease can be missed if oxygen saturation alone is taken as a criteria for the moderate disease. As in the case we saw, there was a moderate disease on CT scan, but the saturations were maintained till day 11, 12, 13. So they, by Government of India classification, it fell into the mild disease, but by NIH classification, it will go into the moderate disease. Moderate illness, moderate COVID-19 illness is defined as evidence of low respiratory disease during clinical assessment or imaging with SpO2 more than 94% on room air at sea level. Given that pulmonary disease can progress rapidly in patients with COVID-19, close monitoring of patients with moderate disease is recommended if bacterial pneumonia or sepsis is strongly suspected. So that is a difference. Now coming to the therapeutics. So what are the things available, what were available? Almost everything is scratched. So convalescent plasma was there, that is also not there now. Antibodies have come now, they are available. Flavipiravir is out, hydroxychloroquine is out, interferon, lopinavir, ritonavir, nitroxenoxide, oseltamivir, remdesivir has a specific role at a specific time. Immunomodulators, in immunomodulators, corticosteroids stand, are the mainstay of the treatment. Then IL-6 inhibitors, they have specific situations where they are to be used. Intravenous immunoglobulins, they have a specific situation where it should be used. Then baricitinib can be used when you are unable to use steroid for some reason or other. Vitamin C, vitamin D can be given, but they don't have a role. But being innocuous, they can be given. Ivermectin, azithromycin, doxycycline, SCQ has been out. Therapeutic classes to be discussed. Antiviral, convalescent plasma, remdesivir, antibodies, immunomodulators, corticosteroid, JAK inhibitors, for example, baricitinib, and anticoagulant. These are the things. Again, we come back to our routine diagram of pathophysiology and progression. So these are the drugs. The shaded zone shows that there is a benefit is unclear. The non-shaded or clear zone shows that the benefit is clear. So remdesivir has a clear benefit in pulmonary stage 2A and 2B. People have used it in earlier stages, stage 1 also, when in high-risk patients. But a clear benefit is in the stage 2. There is hardly any benefit of remdesivir after 12th or 13th day of illness when the patient is already deteriorated. Steroids also has benefit in stage 2A and 2B. Anticoagulants are of benefit from stage 2A onwards, even after discharge. So our whole exercise is to identify stage 2A. If you identify the stage 2A, which will last for about 36 hours, 24 to 36 maximum, maybe 48 hours, and we intervene in that, we are likely to prevent our patient going into stage 2B. So how to recognize this stage, which drugs to be used? Both have abnormal chest imaging. Only in stage 2A, there is no hypoxia, and in hypoxia sets in, once hypoxia sets in, it will be called as a stage 2B. Recognition. Persistence of fever after 5 to 7 days, high grade fever with chills and rigors. That is one factor goes in favor of stage 2A is continuing. And chest imaging, significant chest infiltrates, SpO2 CRPD dimer, SpO2 is normal, inflammatory markers may be increased, plus or minus, D dimers may be plus or minus. Fever grade, any fever more than 99 degree Fahrenheit, especially with weakness and chills. See, chest imaging CT severity score of 8 over 25 plus with clinical features. These will define stage 2A. Generally, the patient who is going to recover from the COVID without any complication, by end of fifth or sixth day, he will suddenly start feeling better, completely better. His body ache, all the symptoms, आपण मराठीत त्याला रवरव म्हणतो किंवा अंगात अजून रवरव वाटते, ती एव्हरीथिंग विल डिसअपीअर सडनली बाय एंड ऑफ अबाउट सिक्स डे. बट इफ इज गोइंग टू प्रोग्रेस टू द फर्दर स्टेज, आयदर विल हॅव अ गॅप ऑफ वन डे अँड देन यू विल हॅव द सिम्प्टम्स अगेन. द सिम्प्टम्स कंटिन्यू, द बॉडी एट कंटिन्यूज, पेशंट फीवर ॲक्च्युली मे नॉट बी हाय, बट द पेशंट सेज आय एम नॉट फीलिंग वेल, I am not feeling normal, and the fever may be in the range of 99 to 100 sometimes. So he is the patient who is now entering into the pulmonary stage. Chest imaging, severity score of 8 over 25 with clinical features that we already discussed. Now coming to the drugs. What are the drugs? Antibodies are coming now. Roche is distributing through the Cipla's network. Just yesterday I read, and they are costing about 60,000 rupees for adult treatment, and they can be given subcutaneously as well as intravenously, and they have to be given in first 5 days. There is no role in severe. Once the disease is established, they will be given to the patients who have high risk and in the viral in the viremia stage. There and then only they have a role. Chronic convalescent sera, also whenever was allowed, had a role, actual role in the first 5 days in a high risk patient. The problem with monoclonal antibodies as well as convalescent sera is that of a mutation. When they are acquired from which wave, and whether the virus has changed to a significant extent, and whether it will respond to this, that remains. If there is a mutation, significant mutations, they both may not work. Then remdesivir, as we discussed, can be started from 2A onwards. The remdesivir works by the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. Then steroids can be started from the stage 2A or 2B definitely, and anticoagulants from the stage 2A. Low molecular weight heparin followed by oral later on after discharge. So corticosteroid dose is indication hypoxemia, dose and duration depends on the severity. Tapering has to be slow in a oxygen dependent patient. So dexamethasone 0.1 to 0.2 milligram per kg. Approximately 6 milligram IV OD for 3 to 5 days, or methylprednisolone 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg, 40 to 60 milligram for 3 to 5 days. In severe cases, injection dexamethasone 0.2 to 0.4 milligram per kilogram for 6 milligram IV BD for 5 to 7 days, or can be extended for another 5 days if the disease is severe. Injection methylprednisolone 1 mg to 2 mg per kg, approximately 80 mg into 5 to 7 days. So no use in less than 7 days unless hypoxia. Tapering over 10 to 14 days. Coagulopathy. COVID-19 is a coagulopathy. It is a thromboinflammation. It is a DIC restricted to the lungs. So, there is initially vascular endothelitis, which triggers the platelet activation, which causes the thrombus, which again leads to endothelial dysfunction. The cycle goes on and on, and this is called as a Virchow's triad in COVID-19. And the thromboinflammation is to be answered by anticoagulation. Anticoagulant therapy, indication clinical risk of thrombosis, lab markers, and dose and duration depends on severity, prophylactic or therapeutic, duration 2 to 6 weeks. Moderate disease, 40 mg subcutaneous enoxaparin and severe disease 40 mg BD. Coming back to our case, day 8 CRP was 18, fever and SpO2 was 96. We started Medrol 24, enoxaparin 40, looking at the CT score. Saturations were still maintained. On day 12, CRP went to 32. Patient became afebrile, but SpO2 started dropping down. So once SpO2 started dropping down, we increased the Medrol to 32 milligram, and enoxaparin was continued. Day 16, CRP came to 6. Patient was still afebrile. SpO2 was 96. Tapering of Medrol was done. Enoxaparin 40 milligram into 10 days. Then shift to oral for 4 weeks. So coming to the conclusion, most important thing what we have to do is a risk stratification and risk stratification. 85% patients do not need any treatment. Monitoring is the key to the success. Laboratory and radiology to be used judiciously. Tests should be interpreted in clinical context. I would read it again. Tests should be interpreted in clinical context. Recognition of early pulmonary stage before significant hypoxia is key to the success. Remdesivir recipients should be watched for pneumonia and development of hypoxemia. Don't be thought that I have given remdesivir and nothing will happen, patient will not progress. I think that ends the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Anand Deshpande, sir, for such a nice and excellent presentation on adult COVID.
It was definitely an excellent presentation. And many a times the question is asked, why pediatrician need to know adult COVID? In this unprecedented era of pandemic, even the orthopedician, paraclinical pathies, they are working in the COVID war. And that's why when people who don't have any medical knowledge, they are abusing modern medical science. So it is our duty to get ourselves updated with the adult COVID also. Thank you. Thank you very much for your lucid talk.
If there are any questions, we can take.
Yeah, there is one question in question and answer. That question is, for how many days the antigen test remain positive after COVID?
Antigen test?
RT-PCR remains positive after COVID.
That is remains variably. In some patients, it may be positive up to 4-5 weeks also. That's why we stopped doing the COVID testing at the time of discharge. The initially, in the month of May, when initially used to admit patient, the 2 test negative was the criteria for discharge. That one, it came down to 1 test negative for discharge. And then that one, they understood that the dead virus also can give rise to a positive RT-PCR. And dead virus remains for a long time. Even at 4 or 6 weeks also, you may find RT-PCR positive. That's why it was left. And it is a clinical recovery or 10 days to 14 days. If it is mild COVID, 10 days more. And moderate COVID, maybe 14 days. In our hospital, many times, after 14 days, patient, for maybe not 14 days, but up to around 20 days, if the oxygen dependency continues, then patient is shifted to the non-COVID side and manage there because he is no longer infective to the others.
Vidubhav, I would like to answer something I would like to add. See, whether it is RT-PCR or antigen test, both tests are done on nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal swab. What they detect, antigen test detects the antigen of COVID virus, various antigen. And what RT-PCR detects, it detects the genome of the virus. So till the time nasopharyngeal or oropharyngeal cavity has virus, whether it is live or dead, it will be detected by both the tests. Viral replication, though, stops after 10 days. still the dead virus can be detected in oropharyngeal or nasopharyngeal secretion. So the test can be positive from symptom onset up to say 2 to 6 weeks. Even in some secretions, RT-PCR may be positive even after 6 weeks also. But after 10 days, it means detection of a dead virus and the virus which is not viable. That is the inference. So antigen detection test can be positive up to 6 weeks. If antigen is positive, is negative, we have to go for RT-PCR test. That is the only inference we can draw.
Can I say
Dr. Jain?
Yeah.
Do you want? Dr. Jain, go ahead.
Yeah, please.
Sir, please go ahead.
Dr. Anand, very lucid presentation. Congrats. It was mind-blowing. My only take-home message are Dr. Jain and Dr. Anil said and Vijay Rote that we don't do repeat test. It may be, when I discuss with them, it may be positive up to even 3 months, they said. Up to 3 months you can wait. But I suffered myself corona last month. So that was one. Secondly, use of remdesivir in adults, because when we see they have got a bad cardiac. So they have got effect on the cardiac. So is there anything that we do we should warn while using remdesivir? Because we have been advocating more than 3.5 kg weight in as low as newborn. So would you advocate something like while administering remdesivir, ECG monitoring or cardiac monitoring or heart rate, pulse rate monitoring?
That's sir, all. Remdesivir has to be given. Remdesivir has to be given in and should not be given in home isolation, has to be given in a hospital setup.
Yeah,
already right. There is thrombotic possibility of thrombosis. Not only in lungs, but various organs like heart, like liver, like gut. So it is always possible that the side effect of remdesivir may be enhanced in such a setup. So remdesivir has to be given in an indoor setup with close monitoring, including temperature, including saturation for detecting the deterioration of the COVID disease itself. So remdesivir should never be given in home isolation. I think has to be given under monitoring.
That note, I think Anand, we must include in our presentation, because that take-home message should not go like people are starting using remdesivir very irrationally, and we will have side effect. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Anand.
Remdesivir, otherwise,
wants to say something.
Yeah, I have one query. The inflammatory markers which might have been raised for a patient who was indoor, like say stage 2 or 3, 2A, B or 3, and then he got discharged. D-dimer, LDH, ferritin, they may be high at the time of admission.
Yes, yes.
So how long we need to monitor them? Because we are seeing post complications now.
D-dimer needs to be monitored for quite long.
Huh.
Especially because you are going to give anticoagulant for a longish period.
Okay.
And as long as anticoagulant is there, then you should monitor. And one or two things I forgot to tell. In oxygen-dependent patient, a high D-dimer of more than 5,000 or 4,000, you should rule out pulmonary embolism. That is one of the common complications. The common day methods of dying in COVID is pulmonary embolism is one.
Yes.
Then COVID myocarditis. COVID myocarditis. Corona is after going home. During the stay, COVID myocarditis will suddenly make the patient breathless, and we will not be able to identify unless we do an echo. So I did adult COVID duty of about 8 days. It is very short experience to tell out of it. But in that 8 days, I saw one or two patients which I shifted to ICU. They had myocarditis. Clinically, you are not able to judge. You are not going to go very close to the patient. And the ECG is frequent ECG and everything is not available. So they crash down, they go to ICU, they are evaluated there, and at that time it is found. So pulmonary embolism should be suspected if an oxygen requiring patient more than significant oxygen requiring patient, 10, 12, 15 liters, and a D-dimer of 4,000 to 5,000.
Nilima, madam, D-dimer will come later compared to the inflammatory marker. Okay. What we have to monitor is oxygen saturation. That is the single most pointer which will indicate oxygen dependency or oxygen requirement. Now, when we see that after the treatment, basically steroid and anticoagulant, these are the mainstay of the therapy. After the improvement starts, the oxygen saturation starts improving and patient's general well-being starts improving. Other parameters starts improving. Then start what starts improving are the inflammatory parameters like CRP, IL-6, ferritin, LDH. These things that start improving. And on this parameter, you decide also, of course, also lung capacity also. Saturation is the pointer to that. That time you decide whether to discharge or not to discharge, whether the child is going, the patient is going for oxygen dependency. D-dimer may remain high longer enough, but that doesn't decide about discharge criteria. Once you discharge, it is the D-dimer which needs to be monitored, and sometime it may take 2 to 3 months to come into normal range. So you have to keep on monitoring. As already said by Dr. Deshpande, sir, pulmonary embolism, cardiac involvement, liver involvement has to be monitored in such patients where D-dimer is high.
So we need to continue the treatment with low molecular weight heparin or the oral medication.
Oral anticoagulant.
Rivaroxaban is commonly used, very costly drug, yeah. But commonly that is used, Rivaroxaban.
When do you suspect impending cytokine storm?
Impending cytokine when the fever continues beyond 7.
Because this is the small window which is available to prevent the complications.
Yes, that will.
Ajay, reappearance.
7 to 8 onwards, of the fever continues. 7 to 9 days are critical.
Continuation of fever, continuation of high grade fever beyond 5 days. And reappearance of fever is a very important thing which has to be monitored after a patient settles down, fever settles down for 1 or 2 or 3 days, and suddenly the fever appears. This is the time to suspect, along with rise in the inflammatory marker.
Thank you, Jayant. Now, due to constraint of the time, we have to move ahead for the next session. Before that, I am very much thankful to Dr. Anand for such a nice presentation and Dr. Jayant Upadhyay for nice expert comments. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Now, I request Dr. Sanjay Nath to continue further proceedings for the next session. Dr. Sanjay Nath, please.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Dr. Deshpande, sir, an excellent presentation on adult COVID. And as you rightly said, adult COVID is going to be the basis on which we are going to think about how to treat and manage the pediatric COVID as and when and if we get severe cases. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now move on to the next session. For the next session, can I invite the chairpersons, Dr. Narendra Naniwadekar, sir, Dr. Pankaj Agarwal, and Dr. Nilima Bhandarkar. Dr. Narendra Naniwadekar is a senior pediatrician from Kolhapur. He is an executive board member for Central IP from the state of Maharashtra. Dr. Pankaj Agarwal is the secretary of Indian Academy of Pediatrics Nagpur branch, and Dr. Nilima Bhandarkar is the secretary of IIP Raigad branch. So I hand over to you, sir and ma'am.
Yeah. Now we are going to see, we are not going to see the pediatric COVID right now. Right now, Dr. Anil Raut from Nagpur will be talking about the psychological issues involved in children, because this is a very important topic. Although COVID is not affecting pediatric age group that much, we do not know whether this third wave is going to affect it in a major way. But we have to know that indirectly, COVID is definitely affecting children because of lockdown, because the schools are closed and they are sitting at home. So one way or the other, it has got a lot of psychosocial impacts on children as well as adolescents. So we have got our expert, Dr. Anil Raut, who is the executive board member for Central IIP 2021, will be giving a talk on this psychological impact. Over to you, Dr. Anil Raut.
Good evening, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Narendra sir, for a decent and a good introduction. But I want to
make one comment. I am not an expert. I have gone through the slides, attended the TOTs, and with this background I am presenting. We all know that this COVID has, we the pediatrician are the first one to be encountered by the children when they come to us for their any physical illness or some problems, and we are the person who tackle them first. That's why it is important for us to know this side of this illness also. So friends, we are going to discuss psychosocial impact of COVID-19 on children and adults. If you look the events, in December 19, COVID was detected in China and it was thought that it will be take a form of a pandemic, and it arrived in March 20 in India. And on 22nd of March 2020, a lockdown was announced in India. It was a very different thing. We had heard about lockup. Lockup, matlab, it is connected with police, and a common man who is away from any crime or will be always away from the lockup. And with this terminology of lockdown, everything was closed. Migrants, they had started migrating from their working place where they were for years together to their home states. And initially the children were enjoying the all the chuttis they were getting. And most important, in April 20, exams were cancelled. So the educational year of 2019 and 2020 was, exams were cancelled. That's why the children were happy. Then gradually, as the first wave progressed, which probably involved more adult and senior citizens, gradually as the months moved, the cases did decrease. The first wave came in a declining phase, and schools were reopened. But this was not a routine school. They had started opening it on online schooling. So this was very new to all the children in the country. And most of them could not afford the online teaching or learning. And due to that also, there was severe impact on the schooling of children. Then afterwards, the second wave came, the schools were again closed, then the number of cases had increased a lot. Then as compared to first wave, the number of pediatric patients getting physical COVID and was more up to 10%. In second wave, we have seen the pediatric patient where they became positive, though the severe illness apart from MIC was not there in pediatric population. But all these had led to extensive stress on the pediatric population, and probably due to that, this part of illness of COVID has not been studied properly. And we are very much thankful to Central IP for coming this topic in this module, so that that aspect of the pediatric COVID should also be covered. And we as a pediatrician, we must know how much psychosocial impact of this disease is there on the children, and how they will present to us, whether it is not a physical illness, but this psychosocial illness, mental illness will be there, and how to identify it at a proper time. And then if possible, if it is a mild one, we'll come to the staging, and if it is mild one at our level only, we can able to treat them and assure the children to have a normal health, that is physical and mental health, in their life. Another important thing was, in second wave, the with increased number of children being positive, they were labeled as so-called super spreaders. And that's why also it has led to, initially in first wave, when we used as a pediatrician, even with IIP, we had taken so many programs for the on the psychological aspect of mental psychosocial aspect in children of this COVID. We had asked them to be with their grandparents so that they can learn something life skill from them. But with the label of super spreaders, they were again removed from the grandparents, and that had again led to much more in the mental health of children in, during this last 14 to 15 months. So friends, these are the common scenarios which you must have experienced. 8 months old Ria, which always want now always wants her mother to be by her side, and she refuses to go alone in, even to bathroom. She wakes up several times in the night and complains that she gets frightening dreams. So this is the one of the scenario you must be seeing in your patients. Then there is 15 years old Saket. He is not attentive in the class. Even the class is online. He looks sad and does not talk to anyone. He has a lot of school work to complete. He is not able to focus on studies. His mother tells that she has started smoking his father's cigarettes. Another scenario, then 10 years old Sangeeta came to the pediatrician for breathlessness, and when on physical examination she was found that she doesn't have any illness, no history of fever and nothing. Your saturation was normal, chest by that brave pediatrician. The chest was also clear, and what was the thing that she was in a thought that she is suffering from COVID. When going to the history, it was found that her maternal uncle has expired in the second wave in a remote village just 5 to 7 days back, and that's why probably she was behaving like this. So these, with all these scenarios in day-to-day life, we now are going to discuss these issues in detail on this platform. So what are our learning objectives for coming 30 to 40 minutes? We want to get acquainted with the psychosocial aspect of pandemic on children and adolescents. Then second motto is to identify high-risk children and families also. Then the third important thing is you have to identify the red flags. Even the child is having mild symptoms of some mental illness, you have to identify the red flags signs in them, and then accordingly you have to tackle them, treat them, or if required you have to send them to the specialists also. Another important thing is interventions in the office practice. As I told you that it has to be a proactive approach. Even a child comes to you for any physical illness in the form of pain in stomach, if you have a proactive approach and you ask some questions to that child, probably you will know that the child is suffering from some mental illness, and that probably had led to his physical illness also. And another most important thing is that to identify the children and adolescents needing referral. So all this we will be discussing in coming a few minutes. So first one is to sensitize pediatrician to recognize psychosocial impact on children and adolescents. As we are the first person to get in contact with the families and a child who is coming to you with all background of this mental illness, the presentation may be in the form of some sort of physical illness. He may be having a simple viral or upper respiratory tract infection, but the family is very much frightened. The child is very much frightened with people not getting beds around, people dying, even the relatives dying of this COVID pandemic. It is important to treat the physical illness. Along with that, you have to just ask few questions to them and identify whether the child is going through the mental illness also. So what has this pandemic led to the children? Definitely, the physical health as such, though the pediatric population has not been affected physically by this illness so much, but they are positive. They are coming to hospital with history of fever, upper respiratory tract infections, though with treatment or without treatment, they may get symptomatically better. But definitely after few weeks or so, they may be getting hospitalized in periodic ICUs, PICUs for MISC or something. So all these effects are definitely there even on pediatric populations. Then important thing is environment and schooling. Schooling has been definitely at a great loss during this 14 to 15 months. The exams have been canceled. The government and authorities had taken step to start schooling in another way, in the on-way schooling, but all these had led to many hotspots, and even the children, they are very much confused and stressed to have online schooling, and that had burdened them with new forms of mental illnesses, which we are going to discuss. So this definitely has led to mental impact, health impact, mental illnesses on these children. So most important thing is the children, they are very much stressed, they are depressed, they are frightened. The physical and social isolation, as discussed earlier, due to separation from their near dear ones in the house, they are become lonely, they are aloof, they are finding themselves difficult to communicate with their families and friends. Even the parents, they are, in some families, they are positive, and children are kept isolated. Parents are there in the hospital. Sometimes the children, they are shifted to grandparents, and probably that had spread the disease to grandparents and other families also. So there is total uncertainty. Everything is in uncertain atmosphere. New guidelines are coming every now and then. If a child asks to his father, when will this lockdown open, the father just console him that it will take another 10 to 15 days. But after 50 days, again the lockdown is prolonged, the shops are closed and everything is closed. The children, they can't go to outside in the playground or in the garden for playing. So all this uncertainty has led to increased stress in children also. Definitely there is disruption in daily routine. If daily routine is being followed regularly, then most of the time the stress becomes less. Giving you a simple example, if you are going to your clinic with the same route on this every day, just tomorrow take another route and you will find that there is much stress on you for driving also. So with this, routine of children has been totally disturbed in this era of pandemic. Their routine daily was to, after getting, get ready for the school, go to the school, come back, play something, have some homework, and then interaction with family, or sometimes going out for social visits. Everything has been stopped. So this disruption in daily routine has also led to impact on the children's mental health. Another important thing is, with all these things, everything being closed, the families who were having small businesses or who were on daily wages, they have lost their income and livelihood, and that had led to more impact on the children's mental health and even with nutrition also. So with all this background, it has been seen that there is accumulation of risk factors. What are these risk factors? Economic decision, as I discussed earlier, there is due to economic recession, the families, they are not able to provide good nutrition to the children. Education is totally stopped. Learning, schooling, everything has been stopped. Health of the children is not being taken care as it was early by the parents and the family members. Their other needs in the form of playing and rejoicing has been totally stopped. Social restrictions are there. There is no play, no recreation is there in their life. they are dumped in the house. They can't even go outside in the to the neighbors to play with their colleagues or friends. Schools are closed. Loss of routine that serve as a coping mechanism. Because for mental health, coping mechanism is most important thing. If somebody is in a stress and if he changes his atmosphere, if there is some stress in the house, if there is maternal quarrel, in the parental quarrel, when the child goes to, he is there in stress in the home. But if he just goes to school, to his colleagues and in different atmosphere, he get cope up and then he comes out of the stress. That has also been totally restricted with this pandemic. There is no social support at work. Friends, extended families, nobody is going to come to you and meet you and just help you in relaxing. So all this thing had led to extended stress in the children also. And most important, media, because they are, children are there in the home. They are hooked up to gadgets. They are watching TVs and they are seeing news and there is bombarding of all bad news from the this social medias, and everything has again led to increased stress in children also. So poor availability of healthcare facilities is also, the all the hospitals in the vicinity have become COVID. There are no beds available. If a child has some sort of non-COVID illness or some any injury, the child is not able, the parents are not able to take the child to their routine hospitals. Either the doctor is busy on COVID duty or his hospital has been turned into a COVID hospital. So all this had led to major impact on the healthcare facilities of children also. Another important thing is that with all this stress family, stress society, child abuse, child labor, today only I had read in one of the newspapers in the vicinity of Nagpur, a family has been caught for child marriages and child marriage. He was going to marry his daughter who was 15 years old, and his answer to this query, to this was that he has less amount of money, nothing was there to do, and then what child, his girl as such was not going to school, and with this small money available and with the facility of only 10 to 12 people in the marriage ceremony, he was going to get his small girl of 15 years being married. So all this had led to tremendous problems in the mental health of the children. So coming to how much is the gravity of the problem? The gravity of physical illness of COVID has been measured regularly, even in newspapers, on television. You are saying this much is the student score, this much has been come positive, this much were tested, and this much number of people have died of COVID disease. But this mental illness is not being studied properly. The study which we are quoting here is also was done in first wave, wherein the impact was less as compared to ongoing second wave. But if you go to through these studies, you will find how much is the will be the problem if it is studies are being done in this second wave. A meta-analysis of 15 studies were done, and wherein around 23,000 children, adolescents, and caregivers were studied. And if you see these figures, you will be, and this was published in India Journal of Tropical 2020, probably last year's final December or November edition. So this is the finding of first wave of COVID. And if you see the figures, negative affected behavior, psychological state was almost 79.4% of children were having negatively affected behavior. Anxiety was seen in 34.5% children, depression in 41.7% children, irritability in 42.3%, inattention, distractibility, loss of concentration was in 30.8% children, and significant fear of COVID-19, the case, the third case which we discussed earlier, was seen in 22.5% amongst the 23,000 children and adolescents who were studying. And sleep disturbance were seen in almost 21.3% of children. Remember, sleep disturbance is the most important thing which has to do something with mental illness in elder children and adolescents. So, another study which was published in Pediatrics in 2020 December, wherein the effect of online learning, which was started in last quarter of year 2020, the findings were physical problems in the form of headache 34.8%, dry eye 48.8%, weight gain in 32.5%, and sleep issues in 41.8%. So all these figures are very significant, and probably with this second wave we'll be having more such figures in our in ongoing studies. Psychological issues in the form of easy distractibility, inattention was seen in 57.1%, irritability in 42%, addiction, cyber crime, cyber bullying, because they are attached to various gadgets. They go through all the social media and television channels. So all these cyber crimes are also seen this time with children also, particularly the adolescents. Educational issues, academic underperformance, even though they were asked to attend online school, their concentration was less, everything was new to them. Even with online schooling, they used to log in and switch off the video, and they used to play or get engaged in other activities. All these things were seen. Even online teachers were bullying these children for their performance. So all these things were seen in this study, and psychosomatic complaints from the from the parents and children were also seen. For not all children were affected. Even with all these things, even if you will be coming, there is a wide range of presentation of mental health in children and even in adults. So some children who were smart enough to gain something from this pandemic also. So what are those things? The children, they understood the unpredictability of life. They learned some life skills. They were able to differentiate between need and greed. Some children were able to know what is difference between me and we. So all these positive changes were also seen in this children during this pandemic era. Another important thing is accepting imperfection in self and other sensitive situations. The children who were much demanding, now they have seen that everything is not perfect everywhere. Even the lockdown which was declared for 15 days can be prolonged up to 2 months. So with all this, they have learned something good also in their life. They have, some children, they have also learned to control emotions also. Then they have learned empathy and kindness to towards other human beings, their siblings, and even with animals. So all these positive things, all also they are seen in children in this pandemic area. They know that it is our civic duty not to go outside when there is pandemic or lockdown announced. They know that if you have to go or something, you have to use mask. So all these rules, they are children, they are also following. You will see that small children coming up with mask in your OPDs. And if somebody tried to remove his mask, he is reluctant to remove the mask. So all these things, positive things, have been there in this era of pandemic, and they are able to have ability to quickly adapt to the new situations. So all these positive things are there in the in spite of this bad situation and very terrific atmosphere of pandemic all over the world. So what are the post pandemic presentation prediction regarding the mental health. So you all know that the first wave came, then the third, second wave is ongoing. We are likely to have third wave. Probably the children will physically more affected. That is the prediction. Then whenever any pandemic comes, it will go with slowly with having some waves, fourth wave, fifth wave, sixth wave, and over a period of 2 to 3 years, it will become epidemic. The disease will take epidemic form or it will go off. So the physical form of this pandemic will go off some or other day, but the mental health symptoms are likely to outcast, because with all these things, the mental health in the children or even in adults, it will be there for years together. So it is this time we have to identify them properly, tackle them properly, and treat them if required. So the prediction is that mental health symptoms will be much more afterwards, even if the physical disease has gone. Further increase in the mental issues will be due to emerging recessions. With all these things, people having low income, many of them, they have lost their jobs. And with all this background, the financial condition at the level of family and in the society will be poor, and the buying capacity and purchasing capacity and everything will be less in the families, and that will lead to increase in mental issues in adults and children. Another important thing that gradually one fine day all the schools they will open, children they will start going to school, but the school authorities will have pressure to catch up the education, catch up the learning, and catch up the academics. So that will again create much more pressure on the children afterwards. Accumulation of inadequately treated and missed cases will surge. So if we don't tackle now, even if with all these programs being going on, cases will be there which will not be tackled properly. And with the decrease in physical presentation, probably the health facilities will focus on the mental health of the people who had been affected by this pandemic. So it is said that there will be a second pandemic of mental health crisis after this physical health crisis. So friends, it's our duty as IIP members, and probably this is the first step by IIP, they can taken in the right direction, that a comprehensive public health response has to be created, and we as a pediatrician has to know the basics of mental health in the children, so that we can put proper foot forward to tackle this crisis which is coming in the form of second pandemic. Innovations of providing mental health and care within and outside office practice has to be done. In spite of having specialties in treating physical illnesses, we the pediatricians are also dealing with for mental issues of children for years together. Now we have to again sharpen our skills regarding the mental illness in the children, and then accordingly you have to act in your office practice or out of the office also. So what are the psychosocial effects on children? The immediate effect and the long-term effect. Immediate effects are distress, frustration, fear, anger, irritability, hopelessness, hoarding, little interest or pleasure in activities, extensive mobile use, addiction of gadget, negative emotions about COVID-19, violence, child abuse, sexual abuse. All these are the immediate effects which are there in the society, which are going there since last 14 to 15 months. But some are visible, some are not. We as a pediatrician has to be, as a medical personality, has to be proactive, search for this effect, and have to bring them forward so that we can treat them properly. What are the long-term effects? Long-term effects are developmental and cognitive impairment, then increased risk of various mental and physical disorders, social problems, reduced life quality, then reduction of life expectancy. These will be the long-term effect of this pandemic in the mental fitness of children and families after and during this pandemic. So this is another important concept of continuum of mental health. If you find a child who is depressed, may not be depressed every time, the stress which had led to him to in this state will not be there. If you tackle and remove the stress, the child will become normal. Or so with this zones have been identified: healthy zone, wherein the child is normally functioning; reacting, wherein the child has some problem, but the child needs something help from the outside, some help from the outside, so that he will become normal, or he may cope up with some or other by himself so that he can become healthy. Another zone is injured state, wherein the impact of the stress is much more, so that the child lands into this zone of orange, wherein there is significant impairment in his mental health. At that time, definitely some sort of intervention is required and can be given by the family person or a family physician who is treating that particular child. Another important thing is totally ill health, wherein the clinical disorders are there, psychiatric disorders are there, severe and persistent functional impairment are there. And then at that time, definitely a specialist has to be intervened and the child has to be treated properly. So this background has to be kept in mind while interacting, having proactive intervention or dealing with the children with mental illness. So what are the psychological conditions on rise in this pandemic? Anxiety is on rise, panic attacks are on rise, obsessive behaviors are there on rise, then paranoia is on rise. Even it is seen in elders also. Somebody, in spite of having no knowledge of medical, is going in paranoia. The personality is on either very depressed or euphoric. So all this mental illnesses, variety of mental illnesses are seen. Depressions and suicides can also be seen. Post-traumatic stress disorders are also seen. And addiction to gadgets and mobiles are there. Drug abuse are there. Delinquencies are there, particularly in adolescents who couldn't find money to buy their daily needs, or they are now in not getting their pocket monies. They are stealing. They are landed into delinquencies. Children and adolescents are not verbalized. So even with all this mental illness in them, they may not be able to speak. They may not be able to come forward to tell their difficulties to their families or even to the pediatricians. So what are the causes for that? May not have the insight or language or ability to communicate with the family members, parents, or even with the caretakers and health caretakers like pediatricians like us. They are not sure whom to talk. That is most important, because they don't find. Sometimes they have colleagues where they can tell something about their mental illness, but they are also aware in this pandemic era. Negative experience of sharing in the past. In the past, they may have told their family members regarding their mental condition, but it was ignored by them, or it was not listened or taken care of all the problems what they have. They have most of the time they are labeled crazy. They are worried regarding they won't be taken seriously. They may be laughed that this is the thing which is happening to you. It is very crazy, and that's why probably you are not fit for a normal society. Everything has been, that bullying is there. They believe that others won't understand and help them. fear of being judged and labeled crazy, may not understand the gravity of their problem. This is most important thing, that they are having some problem, mental problem inside, and probably they don't understand the gravity of this problem, and that's why they are not coming up and speaking to the family members or friends regarding their mental illnesses. So this was what we have learned about how much burden of mental illness, psychosocial illnesses can be there in this in the society, in this pandemic era. Now, we as a healthcare, as a pediatrician, as a person who is coming in contact as a health worker first time in front of the child, we need to identify the children and families who are at risk. So how can it be done? Children and families at risk, they are marginalized with so socioeconomic status. They may have migrant background. They may most of these mental illness are more in female gender children. Most of them have a single parent. Broken families can be there, or there may be some discordance in the marital discordance in the parental life. Then illness or disability in primary care. If somebody is taking care of the child, even the parents, they had suffered COVID, they are away from them, they are hospitalized for 14 days, even the some of them may have died also. So there are few children in the society where they have lost both of their parents. We IP again, we are coming up for caring these people, these children who have lost both the parents in this pandemic area. So all this definitely will lead to increased risk of psychosocial illnesses in the children. Adverse childhood experiences, existing mental health problems, the children who have already having some neurodegenerative disorders or neurodevelopmental disorders in the form of ASDs or some other illnesses may not be able to go to the therapies, and all these symptoms which we have, the diseases they have, even the illnesses such as if a child is suffering from physical illness of nephrotic syndrome, which was going to there to hospital regularly for his regular checkup, everything has been stopped since last 1 year. So all these had leads to stress, increased stress in children, and that has led to precipitation of mental illnesses. Direct COVID experiences, endemicity, death, separation from the families, mainly the children of frontline workers, they are more prone to have mental illnesses. And definitely we need to search them and bring them on the platform where they can be assured, treated, and properly. So another important thing after identifying, there is most important thing is to identifying the red flag signs. So what are the red flag signs? If you see, suspect that there is something, some mental illness in the patient, child who is sitting in front of me, then you have to search for the red flag sign, wherein you can categorize the child in the particular continuum of mental health, and thereby you can plan the therapy accordingly after that. So what are the common symptoms of psychosocial distress in children during pandemic? Irritability, feeling unusual, unusually tired, feeling overwhelming sad, self-loathing, that is they hate themselves, feeling unmotivated, minor aches and pain, negative thoughts, feeling hopelessness, then frequently on the verge of tears, having difficulty in focusing, want to be left alone, they keep aloof of all the family members and siblings, then losing empathy and with others, they are very irritable, always in angry with their fellow siblings. So red flag signs in toddlers and preschoolers are fuzzy and complaining, struggle to focus or engage in play. They are become very aggressive, show atypical regression of behavioral. We have seen regression of milestones in physical illnesses, but here you will find that there is regression of milestones, behavioral milestones. The child who has left bottle feeding now asks for bottles. The child has started thumb sucking, which the child has left months before. Then the nocturnal inuresis, which was not there since last 6 months, there it has now again reappeared. So all this regression of behavioral milestones will be seen in these toddlers, wherein you have to tackle them properly and treat if required. In younger children, the red flag signs are sudden or subacute onset of difficult to manage. So young children which were behaving very good since a year to back, they were listening everything to the mother and parents. Now suddenly or subacutely, they have become very adamant there, and the parents are not able to manage them. This is the red flag sign wherein you should note it down. Misbehaviors are there, then oppositional or defiant behaviors may be seen. Temper tantrums, they throw temper tantrums very frequently as compared to normal thing which they used to do in earlier pre-pandemic era. Mood swings, sad, withdrawn, angry, altered eating pattern, weight loss or excessive weight gain, all these things can be seen as a red flag in younger children. Strong red flag sleep patterns. As I have stressed earlier, that sleep pattern in elder children and adolescents has to be mapped out and searched for the any mental illness. Most of the children with all this mental illness, they will have problem going to sleep, multiple awakening in the middle of the nights, frequent nightmares will be there, not able to take nap during the day, then demanding more attention at nap and bedtime. We have seen the first child who was 8 years old was clinging to her mother because she was afraid of everything around, and all these things can be seen in in children who are having mental illness. Coming to teens, these are most important. They have so many red flag signs which has to be identified and then tackled properly. Mood swings, irritability, anger, aggression, poor self-esteem, poor self-care, then loss of pleasure in doing routine activities, then remaining aloof, not mixing with their siblings in the home, then changes in appetite, changes in sleep, changes in the weight issues. They may become lose weight, or they may become obese. Then repetitive thoughts and behaviors can be there, always asking regarding COVID and COVID everything in the house. Then they are otherwise hooked up to gadgets. They are seen always sitting in front of the computers, or they are saying watching something or other on the mobile phones. Interpersonal conflicts may be there in the family. Substance abuse, the 15-year-old boy in the second case has started smoking. Scholastic issues we have discussed a lot, is really seen in teens and elder children. They may be so much depressed that they can harm themselves in the form of suicide or some bad things to be done on themselves in the form of having self-injuries to themselves. So even the special children, as told earlier, they are having much stress in this pandemic area. The children who were having some behavioral symptoms, the worsening of the symptoms can be seen: irritability, aggression, social withdrawal. Then children with autism spectrum disorders, as they are not going for therapies, regression of the communication skills, and attention will be there. All these things will be seen in the children with special needs. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder children with the same uncontrollable anger, anger difficulty to perform everyday routine, depression and anxiety disorders, then obsession and compulsion will be increased in children. Even the red flag sign, red flag signs can be identified by parents and caretakers, because they bring the child to you, you will find that in spite of having some red flags in the child, you will, you can be able to pinpoint some red flag signs in the caretakers also. So trigger parental trauma or stress response, difficulty understanding and empathizing, parental self-doubt and feeling inadequate, lack of control of their emotions, sad, depression, sleep deprivation, withdrawal and shutting down, they will neglect their children. So all these things can be seen in the parents also, with all this mental illness which is there in the child. You can see that even the parents are also not able to be in a good mental health state, and that's why probably they will not be able to identify the child in the early phase with mental illness, and probably with their own mental illness, the mental illness which is there in the child may increase, and with and that even in from the stage 2 to stage 3 it will progress to stage 4 also. So all these things has to be considered, and then we have, with all these things, we as a pediatrician has to have a proactive approach in our office practice. We have to look and ask questions for basic psychological evaluation of the all the children, whether they are coming to you for any physical illness, and then with proper evaluation probably you will find that there is some or other mental illness in the family, being the child being affected or the parents being affected, and accordingly in spite of treating a child with the physical illness, you should you should be unable to treat the family as a whole. So with this we have to sort out the things properly. So what are the things which you have to consider when you are going to tackle the pediatric mental health problems? You have to ask whether the child is communicating effectively. Does he seek help when in need? Does he focus attention on activities? Does he have smooth and healthy relationships? Does he solve day-to-day problems? Does he follow healthy coping strategies? These are the things which we have to analyze when the child is having some sort of mental illness, and then accordingly you have to plan and put the child in particular category on the continuum of mental health, and accordingly the intervention has to be planned, with the intervention whether has to be done by yourself or the family, with the help of the family members, parents or caretakers, and has to be decided, and accordingly the steps has to be taken. So these are the categories wherein you can put the child with all this evaluation, and accordingly if a child is excelling, no doubt probably the child is not having some mental illness at that point of time. That has to be remembered properly. So with all these questions you will find that the child is excelling, excellent, normal, in a good mental health at that point of time. Probably with some other stage he may land into second, third or fourth stage. So all this has also to be taken considered, and then you have to plan properly. If a child is thriving, that means he has coped up with all the stress which he has got, then he in the third stage probably the child is trying to survive, cope up with the stress which he is getting from his mental illness, but probably he may require some help from the family or a caregiver like you, suppressing the stress which he is suffering from. If the child is struggling, definitely he will need you or the help of some healthcare worker in the form of counselor or psychiatrist to treat his mental ailment. And if a child is in crisis, definitely you are the one who have to decide how the child has to be treated, where the child has to be sent, and how the child has to be recovered properly. Whenever you deal with such children, you have to ask, remember six most important things that are 6M. That is mood. How is the mood of that child? How is the child mixing in the family with other peer groups or at this era of lockdown with other siblings in the house? How is his daily routine? How he is having his food, meals, daily routine? Is it normal or not? Then how is his scholastic performance going on? How much he is using media? Is he addicted to gadget? Then if a child is small, how is his development going on? So this 6M has to be considered, and then with the help of this continuum of mental health, you have to put the child into four psychological states: whether the child is doing okay, whether he is struggling, whether the child is totally unwell, or whether he is in crisis. And depending upon that, the interventions has to be planned. So in younger children, you can ask, show them this smileys, and accordingly you can ask, how do you feel now? If a child says that he is like a number four, that he is scared and upset and anxious, probably he has to, probably if you go in details, he is in the fourth stage of the illness, and he will need definitely something to come out of stress that may be there at point of time, and your intervention will help him to come out and not in a complete recovery. He will start recovering, come to stage 3 and then stage 2 and 1 if tackled properly. So what is the role as a pediatrician in intervening all this mental illness seen in the society, and particularly children of this society? Be available for teleconsultation. If in this lockdown period, if a parent, they are not able to come to you for anything, any physical illness or some other problem, be available for teleconsultation to the families. Then have a proactive approach, inquire, try to find out, is there something wrong in the mental illness of the child, or is this something wrong in the family on the social or psychosocial front? Then identify the predisposing factors, try to treat them, identify the red flag signs. That is most important. That will help you to decide whether the child has to be kept with you for the further management, or whether the child has to be sent to the specialist for further treatment. You have to educate the parents, teachers, and the community as such on the social front, so that the burden of social mental illness in the society will come down. Then you can liaison our professional colleagues in the form of regular professional counselors or a psychiatrist friend to help. You can take their help for treating these children. So be a healer, listen and empathize, be non-judgmental, instill hope in the parents, in the family, or even in the elder children. Empower with knowledge yourself, then impart that knowledge to the society, to the families, so that they can cope up with all the mental illnesses going on in this era of pandemic. Positive parenting style has to be imbibed in the family. Then behavioral techniques has to be taught to the families regarding tackling the mental illnesses in their children. Pharmaceutical interventions may sometimes require, but it is a rare thing to have. These are the general guidelines for parenting which you can impart to your children, patients, families. Ensure healthy nutrition and good physical health. ensure a consistent routine, play rate, and physical activity to their children, help follow new normal with positivity. So this has to be imbibed in the family so that all these things are now for coming years is normal in the society, and you have to follow the guidelines and everything. Limit exposure to news, which are limit exposure to news and social media, which are spreading rumors in the society. Ask the parents to participate in children activity, because as such with the lockdown, they are in the home to play with their children. Be watchful about gadget use, avoid addiction, help in studies. Children should help in studies. Do not stress on academics, because even the schools, they are just exams for this year has also been postponed up to the 10th and 12th standard. So all these things, the children, they have learned that these are the secondary things. The most important thing is to have ourselves healthy in the form of physical and mental health. So that has to be imbibed in the family, and that you can teach to your parents also. Set rules and be consistent with them. So focus on good behavioral more than the bad behavioral. Don't the child should not be always scolded for his bad behavior. If he does something wrong or something good, that has to be appreciated well. Talk about what to do rather than what not to do. Provide more praise and social enforcement. Do not overreact or sleep disturbance, and sleep hygiene has to be taken care, which is most important in mental health. Teach cyber safety to your elder children and adolescents in your family. These are the guidelines for toddlers, parents, because toddlers, they need parents with them physically. So they demand more physical activity. So the parents, they should be there with the toddlers every time, whenever possible, to attend their calls, anything they want. And so physical attendance with the toddlers is must for the parents. That has to be told to the parents so that they can take care of mental psychosocial growth of this toddlers in their family. Children and adolescents, they are the most vulnerable. Older children and adolescents are most vulnerable. Listen to them, empathize and address their worries, address their queries. Use authentic presentation and video about COVID-19 so that they can know, with all these social medias and all this rubbish going on, they will not see all the things which are not as useful and which are spreading rumors in the society. Model life skills like anger management and all these course are there on online. So all these things can be taught to the elder children and adolescents. You can take positive aspect of the online learning, and that can be helpful for the adolescents. Include and in decision making process to inculcate a sense of control. So adolescents, if there is someone health ill in your family, then you can involve decision your elder children and adolescents in decision making, whether to where to hospitalize our grandparents, where to take them, what medicines can be, how the medicines can be. If you know that the medicines can be brought online, ask your adolescent to do it so that he will feel that he is one of the responsible person in the family and he has done something for his grandparent, so that he will feel his importance in the family. Motivate children to follow. Encourage socializing with friends and extended family, though in a virtual way in this time of difficulties. Engage in small household tasks, skills for daily living. Encourage sharing thoughts and feelings with your adolescent child. Negotiate rather than disagreeing completely to your elder children. Then promote hobbies. Show mean to help them others. Pharmacotherapy is not so important. It is a multidisciplinary approach. You as a pediatrician may prescribe some medicine to a child. If you see that the child is in a crisis, then whatever medicine you are prescribing, you have to go through the pharmacokinetics, dietetics, and of the drugs thoroughly, and then prescribe the drug. Start with a low dose and increase if required. But most important thing is the counseling, and counseling is most important for most of the children to treat the mental illnesses in them. Here, the last thing is when to identify a child and adolescents for needing referral. This is most important in the zone of crisis. So what are the indication of referral? Acute, severe mental health symptoms, suicidality tendencies in the family, past history of suicide attempts, then mania, psychosis, eating disorders, substance abuse disorders, neurodevelopmental disorders, comorbidities, poor response to office interventions. So all these things has to be, if they are seeing any one of this, if a child comes with mental illness, who is having some of other physical comorbidity with him, you have to take help of your friend in that specialty so that the proper treatment of that illness can be given. If you find that the child is having some sort of major psychological illness in the form of psychosis or schizophrenia, then if you find that it is not merely a mental illness which can be which is not responding to your interventions in the office, then you have to refer that child to the specialist and be a bridge between the patient's family, patient and the specialist, so that you are there, always there with the family. Once the treatment from the specialist is completed, the child is with you with minor mental illnesses, can be tackled by yourself. So these are the people where you can refer the child for specialty treatment. But most important thing that you should be there in the loop so that you can have your patient back after the treatment of the mental illness. No doubt it was exhaustive, but I felt it was very interesting, so that you as a pediatrician who is looking after the physical health of the child in this pandemic era, you have to additional burden of looking the mental health of the child. We as a pediatrician, as a developmental physician, we are always in there in the emotional and mental part of the child growth. But in this era, this illness which we have discussed are much more, and that's why our responsibility increases in this era also. Thank you. I am very much grateful to Central IIP for giving me the opportunity to interact with you. I am also thankful to the contributors of this module, that is Dr. Swati Ghate and Dr. Samil Dalwai, for making this chapter in this module much more important as I thought. Thank you very much for patient listening.
Thank you, Anil. Very nice presentation. Anil, nice presentation.
Thank you very much. It was very exhausting, but definitely this has opened a new era in the we pediatricians were are hoping to have our pediatric age. Adolescent medicine should be there with pediatricians. So the age of 0 to 12, or rather minus 9 to 12, minus 9 to 18, minus 9 to 22. But this part is there always with us, and this part can be there. We can have specialists in our specialty, super specialist, who will be able to do all these things for the society. Thank you very much.
Excellent presentation. It was a difficult topic basically, but you have covered it so well. And of course, thanks to Dr. Swati Ghate as well as Dr. Samir Dalwai, who have written down an excellent script for this. Now it is open for question and answer. If there are any questions, please, you can ask Rahul. directly. Are there any questions?
Ajay.
Yeah, I would like to ask Anil, now we know that the third wave may come, may not come. After some days, the lockdown would go down and the patients will start coming back to us. We are always in the need of patients as a pediatrician. But whenever we see the patients, now the first thing which I think you also will be doing is asking the entire detail history, especially child is an adolescent, where all these points, where how much time is he spending on the screen, is he himself or herself facing any issues? How is the stress level? How is he going to cope up with the studies, which are, because there is a big gap which has happened in between. So I think all these questions, how are you going to approach once you start with your work, Anil?
Definitely, after that, we will be getting all children with physical illness. The OPDs, they will be flooded with patients, but we can make this in a paper format as a questionnaire, put it in the OPD so that the children who are sitting in the waiting room and the parents, they will fill the questionnaire and bring it to you. After your OPD, you can go through it, and if you are interested, and you can call them back, take their phone numbers and ask them, counsel them regarding what sort of help they are going to require for their mental illness, which is there in the child who has come to you for some physical illness. So that can one of the possibility. You can have a questionnaire written in your OPD, which can be given to the families, wherein you can ask them to write it down. And so probably this can be done.
Yeah, this will be a very good idea. Plus, having a dialogue with them, just making
voice is gone.
Just lending them some ear, probably audible.
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah. The other very sensitive issue is regarding, we are seeing that now the currently, we are seeing that the young generation is getting affected. So say any parents who are between say 31 to 50 are getting affected, and it is happening in quite a few families that either one parent is lost or both the parents are lost. And it is very difficult for us to break this news to the child who may be say 5-6 year old, or maybe just an adult. So how are we going to deal with this?
It is a very difficult situation to break this news. Yesterday we had a very good video on this by Dr. Samil Dalwai, wherein definitely all the points which are stated there will be helpful, but still it is a difficult task for a physician to break this news in the family, particularly a child who is very young, to know what is death and what is life. So it is a difficult job, but with all the precautions, we'll have to do it. We'll have to take help of the family members. We'll have to take help of the family friends of this diseased parents, so that you can break that news to a child. And at the same time, you should be there in the person who is able, who is going to help that child for his for well-being of his further life. Definitely, Maharashtra IIP has come up with the various idea of adopting or helping this sort of this type of children who have lost their parents, both parents in the this pandemic.
Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Anil, Dr. Anand. Excellent presentation. Grateful to Dr. Jayan, Dr. Sanjay, Natu, Nani Vedekar, and almost all who are here, Upendra and Sunita, Nilima, Vijay. My take-home message was that what we are supposed to do, we are very much advanced IAP in tackling the issue in advance. In view of third wave or no third wave. But my request is that if we can IAP disease particular to Jaint and all EPM of Maharashtra, I'm addressing to them. So if you can come out with some flyers or pamphlet in regional language like Marathi, English and Hindi, telling you what are the red flags and parents should identify in toddler, preschool, adult, teens and parents. So these four pages, if you can keep that as a pamphlet in the all the OPDs in the pediatric, 5,000 pediatrician who are there in Maharashtra. That will definitely help identifying them, giving them knowledge, and also getting what Dr. Nayanda was saying. In advance, they can notice that, yes, my child was having this. I must consult pediatrician or I must consult some therapist, whatever the... So this is my request to IAP Maharashtra and to all honorable EBM who are here, president, secretary. So this is what I was thinking while we are going through the deliberations of Anil and Anand. Thank you. It was a wonderful session. Thank you, Upendra. Thank you, Central IAP Maharashtra.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Dr. Deshpande, both the presentations were excellent. Regarding Dr. Raut's presentation, only one comment I'd like to say. Regarding screen use, it's always easier said than done, because now the schools, the tuitions, everything is online. Even the entertainment and communication with friends is also online. So it's very difficult to wean off the child from the screen. So I think we can't help it right now. After the lockdown comes, we come out of it, we have to think again another strategies.
Before the pandemic era, it was we IAPNs who were asking children to get rid of the screen.
Yes.
But now with this change norms, you have to see that you have to bring something positive from the screen also, so that the child doesn't get addicted to the gaming or some sort of phone issues in the... So that has to be taken care with the help of families.
Yes.
It was an excellent presentation both by Dr. Anand Deshpande and Dr. Anil Raut. Both the topics were slightly lengthy and somewhat complicated, but we have to be very proactive in understanding the psychosocial problems of the children after COVID-19. Complex situation is there, never unprecedented, never before met, ever before. So proactive approach, we have to adapt, we have to give more time to attend a child, not only for medical problems, but for psychosocial problems also. So, as has been explained very nicely by Dr. Anil Raut, it is going to be a big issue in the days to come. Not only medical problem like MISC, but the psychosocial aspect is going to have a huge burden. Sorry. I saw a question in question box. Is remdesivir going to help lowering IL-6? These are the two different things. Remdesivir is an antiviral drug of probably some benefit, not 100% beneficial, but of some benefit. And IL-6 is an inflammatory marker. So remdesivir doesn't play in bringing down IL-6 in any way. Inflammatory marker, they come down with proper treatment with anti-inflammatory drug like steroid. And later on, if the patient is not responding, then to other drugs like tocilizumab and other modalities. Frequently, the question is asked whether these monoclonal antibodies or cocktail of monoclonal antibodies will work in a severe COVID. They have no role to play in severe COVID. It is only during first, say, 3 to 5 days they are useful. They should not be used right, left, and center in all the patients, but they should be used in patients who have a high risk of developing severe disease, like comorbidities, like patients who are undergoing malignancy therapy, like severe diabetic, uncontrolled diabetic, like patient on immunosuppressive, long-term immunosuppressive therapy. These are the things, or patient who are taking anti-rheumatic drugs for a longer time. These are the high-risk situation where these things are to be considered. It's a costly therapy and does have some very mild, but some risk. of giving them. So they are to be considered in proper setup. Starting of therapy as far as COVID is concerned, you have to correlate clinically as well as laboratory evidences as well as radiology. Both the things are to be considered in together as a whole, and then only therapy should be started. Anything, Ajay bhai, you want to add?
No, sir. It was a wonderful presentation by Dr. Anand Deshpande and Dr. Anil Raut. I request all the delegates to please join again tomorrow at 3:30 p.m.
Parmanand is talking, no? Parmanand is talking.
Parmanand is there.
Tomorrow Parmanand will be talking, no?
Yeah, Parmanand COVID. Will be speaking on COVID, child COVID. COVID.
Yeah. Before we go, I have the august duty of giving vote of thanks, sir. It was an excellent presentation, sir, Dr. Anand Deshpande and Dr. Raut, sir. And with very clear-cut messages, especially with Dr. Deshpande has taken us to pediatric COVID, discussing the clinical correlation of investigation reports with the picture and the treatment modalities and different stages of disease also. Sir has given a very clear-cut messages. And just to in brief, he has given a very clear-cut message regarding risk stratification, and which is most important. And he has highlighted on 85% patients do not need any treatment, and monitoring is the key to success. That is what. And remdesivir does not mean that the patient is 100% cured. You have to watch for pneumonia. So I thank Dr. Deshpande sir, and Dr. Raut sir has given very nice message that remember to ask the 6 M's, which was very important take home message from this regarding mood, mixing with others, meals, marks, and media use and milestone. And out of that, depending on the responses, to triage the severity of if the patient is doing okay or is struggling or unwell or in crisis. So it was an excellent presentation with very clear-cut messages, sir. And as pediatricians, we must also look for, especially look for psychosocial history is very important, which we tend to ignore in our day-to-day practice. And as we are looking at, the second pandemic of psychological problems coming in children. So it is very important. So I'm go to vote of thanks now. I wish to express heartfelt gratitude to respected Central IIP office bearers, Dr. Piyush Gupta, sir, National President of IIP, Dr. Bakul Parikh, sir, immediate past president, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, president-elect, Dr. Basav Raja, sir, Honorary Secretary General, Dr. Jayant Upadhyay, sir, West Zone Vice President, Dr. C.P. Bansal, who is in charge of the module, Dr. Ajay Kumar Gupta, who is the National Coordinator of this module, and Dr. Uday Bodhankar, sir, thanks for attending and giving your valuable inputs. He is the National Past President of IIP, sir. I also thank Dr. Jayant Pandrikar, sir, who is Maharashtra State IIP President, and Dr. Sadachar Ujlamkar, sir. And my thanks to Dr. Anand Deshpande, sir, and Dr. Anil Raut, sir, who are National EB member and also a faculty of this module. Special thanks to Dr. Narendra Naniwadekar, sir, Prashant Jadhav, Dr. Parmanand Andankar, sir, Dr. Upendra Kinjavadekar, sir, for being the faculty of this module. And heartfelt thanks to Dr. Sanjay Nathu, who's the president of IIP Pune, Pramod Kulkarni, secretary, IIP Pune, sir. And Dr. Vijay Dhote is president of IIP Nagpur, Dr. Pankaj Agarwal, secretary of IIP Nagpur. And Dr. Neelima Bhandarkar, and of course, my dear attending delegates who have been very interactive in this session, and the DIP host, Ms. Akshita. Just a reminder to everyone that tomorrow we will meet again at 3:30 p.m. here for the second day of our module. And sorry for not putting on the video because my internet connection is unstable. So my apologies for that.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
थैंक यू बाय बाय थैंक यू गुड डे बोधनकर सर बाय अनिल नरेंद्र
ओपीडी बंद करा मुझे तुम्हें जैन
सर ओपीडी बंद केली तर कसा म्हणजे भूकमरीची वेळ येईल ना मानले
अनिल रावची ओपीडी 12 वाजेपर्यंत चालते याची 11 पर्यंत आणि आम्ही फक्त आमची ओपीडी 0 आहे
सर पाठवा इथे थोडे पेशंट आमच्याकडे
विजय धोटे सावनेरला करताय राऊत 12 पर्यंत सुनीता इंगे मॅडम थँक्यू नमस्कार
थँक्यू सुनीता मॅडम थँक्यू
चला बेटर
गुड डे
थँक्यू